to Swamiji today. So I just want to briefly introduce the group first, and then I will talk about Swamiji. So this is a group called the Lost Key Group, and it has more than 100 plus members. And most of the members are from the corporate world at very senior levels in the corporate. And the best part of it is that all of us are interested in some form of spirituality. And it is not related to one particular organization. So we have people from all the religions of the country, almost 7 religions, including Muslims, Sikhs, Jains, Hindus, and within Hindus, all different types of people are participating in this group. And this group has been active more in the last 1 year, where we invite one renowned speaker or religion master to speak about something very interesting and share their knowledge with the group. And this is now, I think, the 40th topic that we are having. So I would be very happy to introduce Swami Sudbodhananda ji. So he was born in a highly religious family. Swami Sudbodhananda Saraswati had a spiritual bent of mind from his childhood, and he developed keen interest in Vedanta and studied it from the age of 20 during his college days since 1961. He further underwent intensive training course in Vedanta at the feet of Guru Pujya Swami Chinmayanand Saraswati ji and Pujya Dayanand Saraswati during 1976-78. Swami ji has been a very good prolific writer and has written several books on Vedanta and in English, Hindi, Marathi, Kannada, Gujarati, and so many. And what I would like to also mention is that, his forthcoming book with translation and exhaustive commentary on Anubhuti Prakasha by Sri Vidyaranya Muni will be a unique contribution to Vedantic literature in English. It contains 20 chapters on 12 Upanishads, having about 2,800 verses. The vast topics covered make it almost a mini non-academic encyclopedia on Vedanta.
Okay.
Since 1965, Swamiji is devoted to Bhagwan Sri Satya Sai Baba, from whom he has received immense inspiration and guidance. So I request Swamiji to enlighten us with his beautiful thoughts that he would encourage us to look into the Vedanta aspect. And the over to you, Swamiji. And thank you so much that you have come and blessed us all. And we really appreciate your time that you are giving to us. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jagdish ji.
Thank you so much.
Sadashivasamarambham Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmadacharya Paryantam Vande Guru Paramparam. I know Mr. Litesh Bajita since more than 2 decades. He is an old chum of mine, though there is a vast difference between our ages. Once he requested me, Swamiji, why don't you give a talk to the Lost Key Group? The moment I heard the word Lost Key Group, I was amused. And much more amused when the flyer of this talk was sent with a head and a key attached to it. I said, my God, they've already got the key. Now how the key is lost then? Then I thought, oh, either the key must be wrong, or the key must be right, but they don't know how to operate it. So today, I am going to give you the right key with the knowledge as to how to operate. To operate or not to operate is your concern. Hum mera kaam karega. Theek hai? Now, when you say you are searching a key, certainly there must be some treasure hidden somewhere which is locked. And the search can be more and more frantic depending on the value of the treasure. If the treasure is something priceless, then you can't, the key must be very, very precious. Now, let us find out. What is that treasure you are hunting for which you want to have the key? Let us analyze our pursuit. You may be anyone whosoever, but one thing is certain, you are a human being. Yes or no? If you say no, I will stop and walk off, okay? We are a human being. And we have got many ambitions, aspirations, many things are there, but there is a common denominator in all these aspirations in life. What is this aspiration? The aspiration is, I want to be happy. Not simply, I want to be happy. I want to be happy forever. Not only that, I should not have even the trace of sorrow. And with this happiness forever, no sorrow at all, I would like to live forever. Anybody? Any exception? Is it not? Is it not the human goal? Not only human goal, it is the goal of every living being, including coronavirus. It was a living being only. Everyone. We want to live. We want to live happily, free from sorrows forever. And we take to many means, which according to our shastras are categorized in the category of do and achieve. Sadhana, sadhya. Do this and have that. And for which we are searching this happiness in the world. We desire so many things. We get some of them. We don't get many of them. Even if you got, we lose them. Like that, it goes on. But the question is, with this pursuit of gaining this happiness from the world, is it a one which is successful? There may not be many people. At least one person can you point out who can say, yes, I got what I wanted, thus far, no further. You must have heard the name of Samartha Ramdas Maharaj, the guru of Chhatrapati Shivaji. He asked, Mana tuchi re tuchi shodhu nipahi jagi sarva sukhi asa kona aahi. Jagi sarva sukhi asa kona aahi. In this world, is there a person who can say, I am happy? Can you find out? No. Even the person who is staying in the mansion costing more than 5,000 crores rupees has to undergo liver transplant. Is he going to be happy? And suppose, by God's grace, you are happy. By the time you can claim yourself happy, something happens and you are sorrowful. That means, in this world, what do you want? That happiness, thus far, no further, free from sorrow, is never possible. We don't say, or not the Shastra deny, that in the world, we do get some tinsels of joy. Some joy we do get through the sense pleasures. Shastra also doesn't deny. But have you ever thought of it? To get this thin sense of joy, what is the investment we have to make? Those who have got some sense of commerce will know. Which are the good investments, which are the bad investments, which are the worst investment. I would point out here, not in the worst, we are in calamitous investment. How come? See, look, you, let us take for example, you like a laddu and you want to eat the laddu and you are happy about that. Tell me what all things are required. First, you should have the body. Then your stomach, etc., all sense organs, organs must be in a good condition. Your mind must be in a good calm disposition with that. Means our investment, first investment must be body, mind, intellect. When you say body, its accompanying features are bound to follow. What are those? Janma, marana. Janma, marana. Don't think there are some two dark spots. The most, that is what? Sorrowful states these are. We may not know like that, but Shastra points out. If you would like to know about this, afterwards I'll suggest this website. I have written an article called On the Wings of Death. There you can find out, based on Brihadaranyaka, what all the sorrows one has to undergo to if we get this body. And in Adhyatma Ramayana, it is pointed out, what is that? Pitiable and very disgustable condition of the child in the mother's womb. So these are the investments. And what you get in return, some little joy and here and there. And how long it is going to last, even if you have got the half wealth of the entire cost, the world as such, how long you are going to possess it? When the last day comes, you will not be allowed to take even a single naya paisa with you. You will not be able to take even pinch of mud from here. Strict customs. In spite of this, we are searching for this happiness, free from sorrow, to live forever in this world. Where no one so far has really accomplished. Our condition is like that of an old granny. You must have heard this. Once a granny was searching for something in the street. So she was finding the passersby took pity. This old lady is trying to find out something. They thought of helping us and they also started searching. Within no time, there were about 10, 12 persons searching. Meanwhile, one youngster was passing by. He inquired, "What are you searching?" No, granny has lost something we are searching. Nobody knows what they are searching, but they are searching for the granny. Then he went to that old lady. "Grandma, what are you searching for?" "Beta, I have lost my needle. I'm searching for the needle." He said, "Where did you lose it?" "I lost in my bedroom." "If you are lost in your bedroom, why are you searching on here in the street?" "Beta, there is no light there at all. Here light is there, therefore I am searching here." Can she get? Like that, we are searching what we want in terms of sukha prapti, limitless, dukkha nivritti, total, to live forever all the time. never die as such in the world. It is not working, so we have lost the key now. Now, whom to consult? Two prerequisites will be there. Number one, the person who is going to point us out the key must be a thoroughly knowledgeable person in this treasure hunting. Number two, he should not exploit us. Achha ho gaya, bakra mil gaya. Arabian proverb says, he who knows not and knows not that he knows not is a fool, shun him. Second variety, he who knows not and knows that he knows not is simple, educate him. Third variety, he who knows and knows not that he knows is asleep, awaken him, like Hanuman. And the one who knows and knows that he knows is wise, follow him. Now we have to find such person. Let us consider today's topic is key message from Krishna. Does Krishna fit in this category? Of course, Yogeshwara, Avatara, Sarvajna, Sarvashaktima. So the question is, first requisite is over. That here is a person who knows what we want. The solution to our problem of ever hunting sukha prapti, dukkha, nivritti, and living forever. Now the question comes, whether this Krishna is going to exploit us, whether he wants to increase the clientele of bhaktas. Of course not. From his own mouth, we can listen this. Name parthaste kartavyam trishu lokeshu kinchana nanavaptam avaptavyam varta evacha karmani. Arjuna, there is nothing that is not accomplished by me in this entire cosmos. There is nothing that needs to be accomplished by me in this cosmos. And yet, I am engaged in karma for the benefit of humanity. It is said that duty without love is despicable. Duty with love is desirable. Love without duty is divine. Bhagavan Krishna fits in this category. Love without duty. He has no duty that he has to wield a body. And yet, for the sake of humanity, for the good of humanity, even he is wielding a body. So therefore, we are in the safe hands of Bhagavan Krishna as far as finding out the solution to our problem, sukha prapti, dukkha nivritti. Now, as we already seen so far, we are trying to find a solution to our problem of acquiring happiness and getting rid of sorrow in the world. First, let us find out whether it is the right place to seek happiness. And what happiness? happiness that lasts forever. You can ask Bhagavan. Bhagavan says, you know, please refer to my Gita. I have already told that this, what this world is, I have put a nameplate, a board of this jagat. What is that? Anityam asukham lokam. You know, every building and mansion with a name as such. The name of this world is Anityam asukham lokam. This world is, number one, anitya, impermanent. Asukha means truly joy is not only dukkha. And we are seeking right opposite in this world. We are trying to seek nitya sukha and freedom from sorrow. Our plight is like that of a man, see, who was going for a walk one day. Every day he used to go for a walk. One day he felt too much hungry. And by the time he reaches home and this thing, it is too late. He started seeing here and there if any canteen is there. Oh, he found a canteen. And he went there inside the canteen. And the waiter came, sir, what can I give you? Look, I'm very hungry. I want masala dosa. But I can't wait until the masala dosa. You put masala dosa for me. Till then, give me idli and vada sambar. By the time I eat, masala dosa should be ready. The waiter said, sir, did you not see the board outside? You know what are the board? Non-vegetarian military canteen. Can you get masala dosa, idli, sambar in the non-vegetarian canteen? That is what exactly we are expecting from the world. Bhagavan says, anitya asukha. The jagat is impermanent. No guarantee of joy, more sorrow only. And we are expecting right opposite. Then Bhagavan gives the solution. Anityam asukham lokam imam prapya bhajasvamam. Now again, this bhaja has got a problem. Jatavi bhaja means what? Worship, adoration, singing the glories of the Lord, etc. by clapping and all that. That's fine. That's true. That's true. But bhaj has also got a meaning. Seek, obtain means bhajaswama. Seek me, obtain me. Because I will point you out that you are me, I am you. You may raise your eyebrows, but have patience. Let us see what Krishna has to say. Once it happened, many decades back, when Sati Sai Baba was very young, a youngster asked, are you God? He said, my boy, you are God. When you discover yourself to be God, you will discover me to be God. Till then, even if I claim that I am God, what difference does it make to you? What is the guarantee that I am not going to take you for a ride? So therefore, first discover what you are, then you'll know what the truth is. Now Krishna starts the teaching. In the 12th verse of second chapter, in the second verse of the actual teaching, the entire teaching is contained. The rest of the Bhagavad Gita is only an elaboration of what he has told in the 12th verse of second chapter. The verse goes like this. Natve vaham jatu nasam natvam neme janadhipatam nachayvana bhavishyamaha sarve vayamatah param. I will just give you a running translation. and let us make out whether you can make any sense of it. Say it like this. See, never that I was not there. Never that you are not there. Never that all these kings who are ready to fight this war now were not there. We'll analyze it. Nachayvacha bhavishyamaha sarve vayamatah par. Hereafter, all of us, there will not be a time when all of us will not be there. In short, because the double negatives are. In short, it means Arjuna, me, you, and all these kings were there forever in the past. Of course, now we are there. There is no, that did not be. But hereafter, me, you, and all these kings will be there forever. I think even a child will point out this statement cannot hold good. Why? Krishna says, I was there ever in the past. You know, we know the birth date of Krishna, Gokulashtami. Before that Krishna was born, was Krishna there? Even the name was given afterwards, decided afterwards, not there. And Krishna says he was there before all the time. Okay, we may give some other because this is Bhagavan, Avatar, Parameshwara, maybe that it is possible. He said to Arjuna also, you were there ever in the past. Arjuna knows when he is born, etc. Okay, let us give still further allowance that Arjuna is a great devotee of Bhagavan, so it may be there. What about these kings? They are ordinary people. How they can be ever in the past? Means from our standpoint, it is not going to hold good. Afterwards. Nachayvana bhavishyamaha sarvayamayatvar. We are going to be there forever. You know, Krishna has left the body. A hunter shot an arrow, thinking that his sole of the feet is the mouth of a deer, and Krishna has to leave, has left the body. That means end of Krishna is there or not from our standpoint? Yes. Arjuna, you know, they went for Swarga Arohana and they left. As for these kings, don't ask. The Mahabharata war is imminent. Any time they may pop up. And Krishna says, all of us will be there forever. Now the question is, or the thing is now, either Krishna is wrong or we have not understood what Krishna says. Is it not? We can't say Krishna is wrong. Why? You know, Yogeshwara. Parameshwara, one has taken the embodiment avatara for the good of the humanity, Loka Sangraha. Having come to guide and rescue the humanity, he is not going to tell something lie. The question is, how this statement can hold good? Among the sadhu circles, in Himalayas, there is a story prevalent. What is that? See, two gentlemen with the name Mr. Veda and other one Mr. Acharya always used to move from place to place together. Mr. Veda used to make a statement, the meaning of which used to appear next to impossible. Then it was the job of Acharya to explain how what Mr. Veda had told holds good. Holds good. Now let us see. Once the Mr. Veda said, the newly born lamb ate the tender leaves from the top of a banyan tree. I'm repeating. The newly born lamb ate the tender leaves from the top of a banyan tree. Is it ever possible? Impossible. Then Mr. Acharya came and told me, there was a deep dry well. From the bottom of the well, a banyan tree had grown and its branches were spreading on the ground. The newly born lamb ate the tender leaves of this banyan tree. Does it make sense or not? Like that, the statements of Vedas or statements made by Krishna, etc., because what he speaks is the essence of Upanishad, need to be analyzed, and what exactly they have to convey has to be investigated. This can be done by those who have undergone the discipline of such teaching contained in the Upanishads, Bhagavad Gita, and Brahma Sutras, etc. Now, as a sample, what Krishna has to say to us in this verse, all of us were there ever in the past. Of course, we are now all there. All of us are going to be there in future. What? Have you noticed one thing? When Krishna says, I was there in the past, I am of course now, I will be there ever in the present. He says, you were in the past, you are now, you will be ever in the future. When he said you, how Arjuna has to take? Arjuna say, I was in the past forever, I will be there in the future forever. Accepted. Now each of these kings, if they are told you are like this, each of them have to say that I was there in the past, I am of course now, I will be there in the future forever. The question is centered around what this I is. If you resolve this I and ascertain what it is, what Krishna has said will be clear like daylight. Of course, he is elaborating there afterwards. So the question is, what is this I? You ask a common person or all of us, who am I? You know, Ramana Maharshi used to ask, who am I? Obviously, the answer comes to what? Body is mine, me. Some may say mind is I. Some others say intellect is I. Now let us say, generally, we take this physio, psychic, and spiritual complex of embodiment as I. In layman's words, body is I. we have to verify this claim. Look, all of us are now, of course, I'm the speaker, you are the listeners. All of you are now busy in listening what this speaker is telling. And if I ask, who are you? Automatic. I'm this body. Has to be. When I'm awake, we take this physical body as I. Agreed. We do vyavahara like that on this. When we go to dream, we are not aware of the physical body. We are taking the dream body as I. When we sleep, we are neither aware of the physical body in the waking, nor aware of the dream body in the dream. We know nothing, including myself. But I was there. On waking up, I say, I slept happily. I did not know anything. Now, I am in the waking. I am in the dream. I am in the deep sleep. But what we take as I in any of these three states doesn't happen to be so in the other two states. If you take physical body as I, it is not there in the dream state nor in the sleep. If you take the dream body as I, it is not in the waking nor in the sleep. If you take nothingness in the sleep as I, it is not there in the waking and dream. Who are you? Who are you? You as a common denominator, you are already there. You are there already. Then physical body cannot be God. I am the common denominator in the three states of consciousness, waking, dream, and sleep. And yet, what we consider the I doesn't continue. Then can you find out? Is there an entity that is continuously available in the waking, dream, and sleep? Think, there is one principle. The principle because of which I am aware of my physical body. I am aware of physical world. I am aware of all my waking state experiences. That one principle is the principle which makes me aware of dream body, makes me aware of the dream world, and makes me undergo and be aware of the dream experiences. And the same principle in sleep makes me aware of nothingness. At that time, you are not able to express. There is a reason. Let us not bother for that now. It is a different topic itself. So, nothingness. And then, what is that principle which makes us aware of waker, waking state, waking experiences, dreamer, dream state, dream experiences, sleeper, deep sleep state, deep sleep experiences? What is that? That is what is called as pure awareness principle. Pure consciousness principle. In Vedanta, it is called as what? Chaitanya Tattva. Being born in India, you know what is Chaitanya. We are familiar with the word Chaitanya. Chaitanya Tattva. It is called Chit Tattva. It is the fundamental knowledge principle. It is the fundamental experience principle, because of which all varieties of knowledge are possible. Because of which all varieties of experiences are possible. Same thing in Shastra is called Atma, Brahma. Don't get flabbergasted with the word Atma, Brahma. It is the Chaitanya in you, the pure awareness principle in you, the pure conscious principle in you. That is Atma, that is Chaitanya, that is Atma, Brahma. That is the real I. And do you know what is nature? It was never born. It is never going to end. It cannot be destroyed. Nainam chindanti shastrani. That means, nachainam dahati pavaka. Nachainam kledayanti apaha. Nash marutaha shoshe. Any engines of destruction known in the world cannot destroy them. Najayate Briyate Vagadachit. All Krishna's statement. I can't go in detail all this now. It neither born nor it dies. And do you know what it is? It is Paramananda Swarup. Limitless happiness, ever existing happiness, happiness that doesn't depend on anything. Our joys depend on many things. Happiness doesn't depend on anything, yes, sir. There is no trace of sorrow in it. I am not telling you a big hypothesis. I can prove this right now here if you are available. Please tell me, in the waking, are you prone to be sorrowful? You may not be sorrowful, but are you not prone to be sorrowful? From where does this sorrow arise? Physical body, surroundings, and phenomenal powers. Tsunami, etc., thunderbolt, lightning, etc., earthquakes. Fine. This sorrow is possible because of this body. In dream, sorrow is possible. Why? In dream, you are no physical body, but your psyche is there, mind is there, source of sorrow. When, of course, in the waking, mind is there. And because of the mind also, sorrows are there. When, see, look, I am not asking you to believe, but please think along with me. I am not going to give you anything new. It is there in the Upanishads. I'm just simply presenting it to you in a simple form. I'm doing a postman's job. But to verify it is your job. So, waking and the dream, we are prone to be sorrowful. Means when the physical body is there, when the mind is there, we are prone to be sorrowful. In sleep, physical body is not available, mind is not available, no sorrow at all. Is there anyone who has suffered or experienced sorrow in the sleep? He may suffer because he doesn't get sleep. That's a different thing. Even a terminal cancer patient, if he sleeps, no sorrow. My body is cut off. No sorrow. That means, what does it mean? So long as body, mind are there, sorrows are there. In the absence of body, mind, sorrows are not there. Therefore, sorrow is intrinsic feature of body and mind. Which you find from the sleep. When they are not there, no sorrow. Another thing, when we wake up from the sleep, what is our experience? A universal experience, whether a beggar sleeps or a Maharaja sleeps. I slept well, I did not anything. And that, what is that? I slept well, I slept happily. Is it not? Do we not remember that I was happy in the sleep? That's why one day you may forgo your dinner, but not the sleep. Even such talks are going on, so maybe sleeping also. Now tell me, sir, from where do you get that happiness in the sleep? Is it because you are relishing a delicious dish you like? Is it because you are listening to melodious music? Is it because you are smelling a fragrant rose? Is it because you are seeing a beautiful sight? None of these are available. Why? Body is not, mind is not there, senses are not there. And yet, happiness is there. Now tell me, who is there present? I is present. But unfortunately, ignorance is there. I know not what I am in reality. Means the I in reality, this Chaitanya, Chit, pure awareness principle, pure conscious principle, by its very nature, is happiness free from sorrow. Then why do we suffer? Because of our wrong identification. We have taken the body as I, have it. Sorrows of body appear as mind. We have taken the mind as I, the sorrow of mind appears as mind. We are free from these, that pure awareness principle has to be necessarily what? Paramananda Swarupa, no trace of sorrow because these bodies are not. And yet, something is obstructing us from directly experiencing this Chaitanya I as Ananda Swarupa, free from sorrow. What is that? It is our 24/7 experiences. It is our waking state experiences, dream state experiences, deep sleep state experiences. They are denying us the experience of our limitless happiness nature. All the time being one fact that, what is it? These 24/7 experiences are possible because of that Chaitanya pure awareness principle. Then we should have happiness. No. It is color by where our mind is preoccupied. Where is our mind preoccupied? Well, in the Shastric language, Vishayas. Vishayas means sense objects. Shabda, Sparsha, Rupa, Rasa, Gandha. The five types of sense stimuli. So, is it there? The point is, these are the sources of sorrow. Whether the body or the world around is a source of sorrow. And this pure awareness, which enables our all experiences, is colored by this. What you have to do now? dissect one thing. If you have not learned many things from this talk, please learn one thing. All our experiences, 24/7, are reported to us, are presented to us through thoughts. In the waking and the dream, gross thoughts. In the sleep, thoughts are not there. What we call that is subtle vrittis, called avidya vrittis, subtle aspects of ignorance that is there present in the deep sleep state. So, but thoughts in the waking or in the dream or subtle things in that, these are all inert. They are made known to us by this Chaitanya pure awareness principle. Just imagine Mumbai totally drowned in pitch darkness because electricity failed. All things and beings, objects are there intact, not seen. Suddenly power came, all lit. Are you not aware of it? Just as light illumines or makes us see the non-luminous object, so the Chaitanya makes us aware of experience of our all varieties of features of experience. So in and through 24/7, the Chaitanya Atma, I, always is there, but covered by specific features of the where our mind gets preoccupied, the sense objects in terms of sense pleasures that we seek, the joy that we seek from the world. That means our mind is preoccupied where? In the world. And Bhagavan has already said, anityam asukham lokam. That extrovert mind needs to be checked. And it has to be made to discover your swarupa. This is where the role of lost key comes. And do you know what is that lost key? It is our mind. Now you will know that we have not lost it. And even your logo also put in that key is there. So my assumption is correct. What is that? Oh, either these people don't have the right key, or they have got the right key, but they don't know how to operate. Now you come to know, you have the right key. And yet you are searching for that, means you don't know how to operate. Yes or no? You have to accept. Now before that, tell me, have you got a mind or not? Never mind. There's a dull or sharp. Don't. Have you got a mind or not? You know, you have got. If you don't have the mind, I will ask the host who is sitting next to me to cut off the link, okay? You have got the mind, means you have got the key. Why not? But problem is, we are turning into the wrong direction. We are locking the treasure instead of unlocking the treasure. Treasure of I, Chaitanya, is only there. And yet, we are like the beggar who inherits 1000 crore worth property and yet begging. That is our plight. I am not exaggerating. This is Trivara Satya. Truth, nothing but the truth and truth alone. Krishna says it. Vyasa compiles it. You know what is Vyasa? Vyasa is the one who has not uttered a lie even in joke or humor or sports. Because see, in sports joke, if you tell a lie, Chitragupta doesn't punch at Papa. You know what he says? Mind we have got. But it is where preoccupied, where in. So therefore, the mind which is preoccupied in the Vishaya as a sense object has to be turned to I principle, the divinity principle, the Bhagavat Tattva, the God principle. Yes. I will demonstrate, okay? Now, what is this? You know, he is there or not? He is there, okay? Now, let us see. Now, it is locked. Now, you want to unlock it. Now, see my hand. Something wrong, okay? I turned wrongly. See, look. Now it is locked. See, locked. Now treasure is hidden inside. We have to unlock it. Now look. See. I am turning to right, or I am turning to clockwise. Is it not open? Treasure is open to it. It gets closed. Why? See. Turning left or anti-clockwise. Locked. If you understood this, you understood the problem. How come? See. Now let us take this padlock. Turn to right, open. Turn to left, locked. Fine? Likewise. This key is your mind. Your mind. This is your mind. Now, open. Right. Turn to the right. Which side is right here? Let your mind be preoccupied where in this I, this divinity principle, Chaitanya, Atma, Brahma, Bhagavat Tattva, Ishvara Tattva, whatever you call, one and same principle. Now, turn to Vishaya, sense object, sense pleasure, locked. Where is sorrowful? You are sorrowful. I have not given you from my pocket. This is what many Upanishads declare. Mana eva manushana karanam bandha mokshayo bandhaya vishayasaktam muktyai nirvishayam mana. Mana eva manushyanam karanam bandha mokshayo. One and the same entity, what is it? Mind is the cause of bondage, means sorrowful existence. Or moksha means enjoying the paramananda, limited happiness, free from sorrow, existence forever. In simple words. Now, how to get it by the same mind? Bandhaya vishayasaktam. So long as your mind is preoccupied in sense pleasures that we are being 99.999999% people who are doing that. Sorrowful existence cannot be avoided. Muktai nirvishyam mana, mind withdrawn from sense pleasures, sense object, directed towards I, Chaitanya, Atma, Paramatma, Brahma Tattva or Ishvara Tattva. Muktai, it serves as the means to claim and experience our limitless happiness. Otherwise, the same mind serves as the means for sorrow. So therefore, the key that we have lost is nothing but the mind, but we have to operate in the right direction. The treasure that is hidden is our true nature, the real I, not the notional I of the body, mind, intellect, I, not that. The true I, which is limitless happiness, free from sorrow, no birth, no death at all. But the problem is, our pull is where? Vishaya, sense pleasure. Thoda maja maja milta hai. How to bring it back? Difficult. Yes. Difficult because we have not thought it properly. Inquire properly. Shastra says, don't take the things for granted. The vishaya sense objects can give us some happiness, but that happiness is not really intrinsic feature of the thing. That happiness is for our real nature only. How come? I want that, 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 I want that. Mind is in the world, state of flux. Then I have to do this, that, that, we got to get it. Even after getting it, I have to enjoy and whether there's no guarantee that it will give happiness or not. When I get it, Abba, I got it. At that time, truly speaking, that moment, you have no desires. What your desire was there is fulfilled. New desire is yet to come. And then at that time, your mind gets hushed up. In that quiet state of mind, your real nature, I, peeps out as it were, and you get the experience of happiness. Therefore, the whatever tinsels of joy we get from the sense pleasure is our real nature only, but mistakenly superimposed there as the source of all happiness is you only, the your real nature, Chaitanya. You can find out when you are not asleep, you are not aware of anything in the world, you are awake, you are not asleep. You are awake, but you are not awake to a specific object. That state of mind has to give you happiness. That is Atmananda, that is Brahmananda, that is Bhagavat Sarupa Ananda. Of course, that state is not that easy. That state can be only Nirvikalpa Samadhi. You are not asleep. You are not aware of the jagat, you are what you are. See, oh, very difficult. Don't worry about it. You go ahead. As you proceed, you are bound to reach a state to discover this. See, you are walking in a forest and you have to cross the forest 10 kilometers. You have got a torch, a flashlight. It puts light for 10 feet only. But you proceed again 10 feet, again 10 feet, whole 10 kilometers will be limitless. So therefore, so now to suddenly turn this from our present preoccupation, the sense object and sense result becomes difficult. So Krishna gives a remedy for that, which by name you must have heard many times in your these different talks by different masters. Karma Yoga. Do your karma, but what? Don't get affected by the results of action. See, generally, what is our concept? When we do a karma action to get something, this karma is mine, underline mine. These results, phala, are due to my efforts, underline mine. I am the person entitled to enjoy this. I am, underline that. I did that karma, underline I. I deserve the phala, underline I. I shall enjoy the result. I shall, underline it. You know what is I strengthen? Your notion that the body is I. In Vedanta, in Bhagavad Gita, when you discover a Swarupa, the first casualty is this wrong, erroneous I notion. Therefore, all things which strengthen the body as I should be discarded. Krishna says, look, your karmanne vadhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana ma karma phala heturbhu ma te sango swakarmane. Most often quoted verse from all platforms and equally most wrongly interpreted verse this is. What does it mean? It means like this. See, your business is to be concerned with the action karma alone and never its result. Do not be the author of your results. Let your inclination be not towards inaction, not doing action, because the phala is not the criterion. If your mind is always on the result of action, your mind is a state of agitation. Bhagavan Krishna has never told that you will not get the result. All that Krishna says, do and deny the result of action. Do and deny the result of action. Having done, nobody can escape from the phala unless you are a jnani. Do and deny. This freedom is ours. I can do and refuse to get affected by the results, right or wrong. That is what Krishna wants us to do. Now you may ask, if that is the case, who will look after us? A karma yogi is fundamentally a devotee. He has got devotion towards Bhagavan and he knows Bhagavan will take care of him. Yoga kshemam vahamyam. I will take care of the responsibility of these people. So he has got all Shraddha in Ishvara. What needs to be done, he does, not bothering about the results of action. Not that he gives us result. They will take their own course. I am not bothered about it. I have done what needs to be done. Kartavyam kritam maya bhavishyam bhavatyev. Bhavishyam bhavatyev. I did what I have to do. What is going to happen will happen, because it's not in my hand. The results of action by governed by Ishwara. Not on that. Therefore, Krishna says, don't bother about that. That is my job. You do what needs to be This is what karma yoga means, do and deny. And then nishkama, 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 nishkama. Then not that you don't desire, etc. It will come, you don't bother about that. See, this karma yoga has been interpreted in many ways in terms of practical, vyavahara, etc. So long as it helps, well and good. But this is the basic principle behind it. So that you will command a mind which is calm and composed, which is the first requisite to know your Swarupa, Ananda Swarupa. A mind in a state of flux can never know what your Swarupa is. A calm and composed mind only can know that. So therefore, Karma Yoga is one of the means. So that means the case, we do our duties, but as in dedication to whom? Ishwara. Ishwara means Paramatma Tattva. The Chaitanya Tattva, Atma Tattva. So that is the one. See, Ishwara. The question is, where to find out this Ishwara? Where is available? Vaikuntha, Kailasa, Brahmaloka. Either I. First, we don't know who that Ishwara is. Whether he is he or she, we don't know. Don't bother about that. Somebody said, Yadrishosi Mahadeva Tadrishaya Namo Namah. O Mahadeva, O Shiva, O Bhagavan, I don't know who you are. Whatever you may be, my namaskara, it reaches it. He gives a reward for that. But where to find this Ishwara? We don't know where this Vaikuntha Kailasa, how to reach it. Krishna has told me. Krishna has given the permanent address of Ishwara. Ishwara Sarva Bhutana Hridye Arjuna Tishtati. Arjuna, do you know where Ishwara is? Sarva Bhutana Hridye. In the Hridaya, the Antakarana, the psyche, the mind, Bhagavan is there. That Chaitanya is Bhagavat Swarupa. This is the permanent address of Bhagavan Ishwara, our Hridaya. Vaikuntha, Kailasa, Brahmaloka are care of addresses. No guarantee will be there. He may be on tour. So therefore, this is what. So, and he says, Tameva Sharanam Gacchi. Deliver yourself in his hand. Tat Prasadat Param Shantim Sthanam Avapsis. By his grace, get Param Shanti, Moksha Kahindi, Paramanda Sarupa. Your real nature Sthana will get you. He will take care of everything. See, Bhakti is the most effective means to final goal of knowing what I am in reality. To be aware of this. And in this context, you should be aware of something which I would advise you not to enter into dispute. Do you know what is that? Whether Dvaita or Vishishta Dvaita or Advaita, which is true? See, look. If it depends on what you take as I. If I take this body as I, Ishwara is the master, I am the servant. Dvaita. Ishwara, me different. If I take Jiva as I, Ishwara is a whole Purna, I am an Aushar, Vishishta Dvaita. If I take Chaitanya, pure awareness as me, Ishwara and me are one and the same. Can there be greater devotee than Hanuman? Once Rama asked Hanuman, Hanumat, what do you think of me? You know what he said? Bhagavan, Deha Buddhya Tava Dasoham. If I take myself the body, you are the master, I am the servant. Jiva Buddhya Tvadamshakaha. If I take Jiva, the psyche with the Chaitanya in that, as I, which transmigrates, you are the whole, I am the part. Atma Buddhya from the Chaitanya. Tvamevaham itime nishita mati. You and me are one and the same. No dispute at all. So therefore, Dvaita is true at its level. We have to make use of it. A step ahead, Vishishtadvaita is true at its level. Finally, you have discovered the one common denominator, Jiva and Ishwara. As Swami Vivekananda puts it, we travel from truth to truth, but never from untruth to truth. It happened. Once, a great staunch Vaishnava Bhakta went to Ramana Maharshi to find out whether he accepts bhakti or not. And he said, with all humility, etc., he went, sir, I'm doing all this, etc., etc. I have done the yatra of 108 deshas. 8 deshas means, in Vaishnavism, 108 Vishnu kshetras I visited. And I'm doing all this. Ramana said, great. You're such a great devotee. Very good. But Maharaj, will you tell me, after I die, will I go to Vaikuntha? Why not? Having done so much, you are surely going to go to Vaikuntha, Ramana Varsha. Then he said, if I go there, will I be able to see Vishnu? Yes, you'll be able to see Vishnu. But will I be able to go near him? Certainly you'll go to near him. But if I go near him, will he speak to me? Why not? He will speak to you. What he'll speak to you? He said, he will tell you, find out who am I. Finally, where? Come to this point. Find out who am I. No doubt, bhakti are two types. Parabhakti, aparabhakti. Aparabhakti is lower bhakti, nine navavidha bhakti, the sadhana. Parabhakti is superior. Satu parama prema swarupa, Narada has defined it. Parama prema means what? The devotee is so identified with the Bhagwan, Bhagwan, Bhakta, Bhakti, Koles, Bhagwan alone remains. That Bhakti is equal to Atma Jnana Brahma Jnana. Huh? That's why I said, Tesham Aham Samudharta. Vrutya Samsara Sagara. Those who are totally devoted to me, I will take the responsibility. I will uplift them from the Samsara Sagara. Therefore, I would say, don't enter into this, what is that, argument, Dvaita, Advaita, Vishirata. Leave it to Bhagavan. You tell me one thing. Are you not sure that Bhagavan knows what is the truth? If you have not that confidence, what worth is your devotion? Let Bhagavan know. He knows everything. Yes, sir. So that's why don't enter into this. To that. And one thing, that means to know me is the goal of life as far as a human being. What I said, Devon? This is the knowledge which is above all religions, including what you call Hindu religion. And in the Hindu religion also, there are many matas. Vaishnava, Shaiva, Ganapatya, Shakta, etc. All this is above all. This is found in Kenopanishad. Means religions, if properly taken to without fanaticism, should help us to develop that frame of mind to know what Bhagavat Tattva is. But Bhagavat Tattva is above all because it is free from nama, rupa, name and form. Yes, sir. It is called as what? Taranavidya. Taranavidya means knowledge of crossing over the samsara. It seems olden days. Once a great scholar, Pandit, was crossing a river on a ferry boat. Only the ferryman was there. He was there. No other passengers were there. But don't they used to row the ferry for one person also. And he has to cross. And he was alone. He got bored. He started conversing with the ferryman, boatman. Hey, you don't have watch? Sir, why do I need watch? I know when to come and run. No, you should have watch. And then he said, do you know Gadya? Gadya means prose. No, sir, I don't. You do know Padya? Means poetry. No, sir. Hare, your 25% of life is gone, least. Do you know Vyakarana? Vyakarana kya karna, sir? I don't know Vyakarana. Another 25% gone. Then he asked, do you know mathematics? No, sir. I know how much to say from here and there, how much money is there and how to count it, how to change back. That much I know what I need more, sir. Another 25% gone. Means 75% life gone of this. Meanwhile, God, unfortunately, the boat started leaking. And the storm came. The boatman said, sir, do you know swimming? No, your whole life gone and you jump. What is thinking? What is the use of your science and Nobel Prize, etc.? If we are a human being, we don't know how to cross over this. You know, don't take this human body for granted. The great reward. Jantu naam nara janma durlabham. Among the jantus, the Narajanma, human embodiment, is very difficult. Having got it, it is meant for this. If we don't get this, we are no better than quadruped animals. Vyasa at one place remarked, Jnanena heenaha pashubhis samanah. Those who don't know what this I is, are no better than animals. Ashubhi samanaha. So therefore, Kenopanishad gives a warning. Iha cheda vedit. Before you leave this body, if you know what I am in reality, atha satyam asti. Well done, well done. Na cheda vedit. If you don't know, Mahati Vinashti. Colossal, calamitous read in terms of Janma, Marana, Janma, Marana, Janma, Marana. Better we make best use of our human life. With some grace, we are born as human beings. It is not meant for khao, piyo, baja karo. Even the animals do that. It is for this purpose. And it may be I don't have that capacity. I don't have that eligibility to get it. Never mind. Send SOS form. Pray to Ishvara. Pray to Bhagavat Tattva. He will come to your rescue. And see to that you are navigated properly. Sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam vraja. Aham tva sarva papebhyo mokshayishyami vasucha. Dharma means karma there, not religion. Hindu, Muslim, etc. were not there at that time. Free from all karma, surrender to me. Deliver yourself in my hand. Afterwards, it is me who will rescue you. You don't want it. Ma shuchaha. Is the abhaya. Don't worry. I am there. So therefore, let us first know what exactly Bhagavan Krishna wants to convey in Bhagavad Gita. And let us put in our action, translate in our life as such. Success is guaranteed. Please think over it. Of course, it's a subject which is very elaborate. Repeated study is required. If you are interested, you can get me on YouTube. Just put Swami Shuddha Bodhananda. My channel will come there. Or if you want more exactly, so here is the website. Rubhu Vasishta at wordpress.com. Rubhu Vasishta at wordpress.com. So there, you'll get the link for YouTube. Did not mean to put your name only. There are good, interesting articles also. Especially, I would like you to read On the Wings of Death. There are Nasadiya Sukta. There are many good articles there. Whether prayers are answered or not, it's nice, good. But On the Wings of Death, and whether prayers are answered or not, at least for my sake, you read these two articles there. It is very helpful to you. Thank you all. It is a joy to be with you all. The last key group. Thank you. Oh.
Yeah. Thank you, Prabhuji. Thank you, Swamiji. On behalf of Lost Key Group, I really thank you for beautifully explaining us this entire concept in this 1.5 hours. The way you built it up, it was so beautiful. You started with the mind, senses, and then you connected us to that Chaitanya. That principle, and from there you took us to the karma principle of how the whole body and the karma is where we do work selflessly for the Lord, and then you talked about devotion, and finally the Bhagwan or the God principle, and you connected it so beautifully for all of us. I have no words to express my gratitude to you, Swamiji, and I thank Litesh and the entire team of people who have gathered here today to listen to your talk. I think each one of us has gone at least some notches higher up in our understanding about what this beautiful concept of Krishna, the message that he wants to give through you. And I really thank the Bhagwan for having you to come and speak to us. So my humble gratitude to you, Swamiji, and I pray that we all listen to you more on your YouTube channel. And I request you to come back to us once again with the same love and uplift us to the next level if possible. So really thank you from the bottom of our heart. And thank you on behalf of Lost Key and every member that is present here today. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna.
Om Tat Sat.
Om Tat Sat. Yeah, any questions? Any person wish to ask one or two questions, Swamiji? Can we take one or two questions?
Are there questions? Okay, ask.
Just one or two. Any person would like to raise your hand or something and can ask a question?
Just 5 minutes, not more.
Yeah.
See, no questions mean two possibilities. Either totally understood or not at all understood. So I will take totally understood, no question. Any question?
Swamiji, this is Venkatesh here. I have one question. Anyway, thank you for this wonderful session, Swamiji. It was really enlightening for us. The question I have is, when you said, when Krishna says to Arjuna that you are always born, you're in the past also you were there, and you are now also, and you are, will be there in future, and I was also there in the past, I'll be there in the current and future. So when he's talking about it, there is a distinction between the God and the other entities, the other living entities, very clearly it comes out. So that I was keeping in mind. But when we now came at the end of your session, you talked about the Dvaita principles, and then he said, actually you are one and the same at the Atma level. So that actually now here in the last concept, these two getting mixed here, whereas when Krishna was telling, it was appearing to be independent, separate, but they were all living there together, eternally, forever as a souls. So can you help us understand this coming together versus
yes, being I got it. See, look, Natvayam, etc., what I said was, the truth of that Krishna statement is centered on what I is. Our notion that body, etc., is I. That is not Krishna meant, because body has got a birth, it has got a death, and what Krishna said cannot apply to the body. So therefore, what Krishna said I about himself, when he said about Arjuna, the I in Arjuna, when he said about kings, the I in them is one and the same Chaitanya Tattva, pure principle. Now, to understand this truth, our mind has to be ready. Coming to the practical aspect. So, for us, the same Chaitanya Tattva presenting as Ishvara Tattva form becomes easy for us. How are we to relate with this? Three possibilities are there. I may not have that acumen to discover the truth, Chaitanya in all as one. But I can certainly adore the Bhagavan as a devotee. Bhagavan is there, I am here. Dvaita. If I rise a little above, I don't take this body as I, but the Jiva who transmigrates. I can't give the definition of Jiva, etc. It is Sukshara. Sukshara is there. Then what happens? Ishvara is the whole and me as a part. Truth at that level. And it helps me to relate myself to Ishvara. But if I rise above Chaitanya in Ishvara, Chaitanya in me, Chaitanya in all living beings, one and the same, just as one electricity is in and through all gadgets. The ultimate truth. So what I said was, let us not enter in this argument. Let us strike the common things. What is that? Have we not got that much Shraddha that Ishvara, Bhagavan knows, Krishna knows the best? Deliver yourself in the hands. Let him decide whether Dvaita, Advaita, or Vishishta, Advaita, what is this? So, but you proceed ahead. That's all. Well, from the time of a practical standpoint. Oh. Otherwise, because this becomes a matter of big discussion and dispute in which you lose your pursuit of sadhanas, etc. And your progress gets hampered, getting lost in this. That's all I meant as such. So therefore, there's no contradiction there. Truth is one and the same, but to what extent I am able to tune with that, that depends on my capacity. But if I have got the total Shraddha in Ishvara, he will lead it. He will navigate us. Like Pandavas won the Mahabharata. Not an easy job. If Krishna were there, it's not possible. But then, have that Shraddha. Shraddhavan labhate jnana. Saushayatma vinashyati. So from that standpoint, okay, I think that's enough. Fine. All the rest you can listen my talks on YouTube. But one thing, my teaching is not beating around the bush. It is little, I'm true to it. But don't get frightened. Because subject matter of Vedanta is so that You simply continue. Even if you have not understood, go further. The same topic from a different standpoint will go on, etc. And one more thing, Zara, see, I am teaching Bhagavad Gita and what is that? Mandukya Karika, etc. with Bhasha, Shankara Bhasha. Lot of Sanskrit will be there. Don't get frightened by Sanskrit. Whatever I teach Sanskrit, there is English parallel there. If you have got the knack of tuning to the English there, even if you don't know Sanskrit, you will know what I have taught us. Remember, I am teaching this Vedanta for more than 4 decades. I have taught to the students who have not studied Sanskrit even up to SSC level. I have raised them step by step, step by step. And I have to remind you, I have taught them Brahma Sutra with Shankara Bhashya, Bhagavad Gita with Shankara Bhashya, Upanishad with Shankara Bhashya. Step by step they were raised. So it is a subject matter. So just so that, don't get bothered about this Sanskrit as well. But plunge, there is no other escape as well. So, and if something is there, devotion is something with a great, without devotion you can't proceed at all. So that way, you would have a little samanvaya of this. Okay, thank you.
My last request is for everybody to, if you can switch on your cameras and, you know, let Swamiji see us, Guruji see us. So we also get his blessings with his personal eyesight on all of us, you know.
Okay.
Drishti on all of us really will make a big difference in our life, Swamiji. So please put on your, start on your videos and get the blessings from Swamiji himself.
But I have to do what you have to do.
You have to just bless us, just have a look at us.
Jitesh is here, Jitesh will help. Hari Om, Namaste.
Namaste, Namaste.
Namaste.
Hari Om, Swamiji.
Hari Om.
Hari Om.
Hari Om.
Swamiji. Swamiji. Pranam. Pranam.
Hari Om. Hari Om, Swamiji.
Hari Om. Okay, all, I think videos are over. Those videos are on. Where?
Hari Om, Swamiji.
Hari Om, Hari Om.
Thank you.
Goodbye. Hari Om to all. I'm leaving.
Hari Om, Swamiji. Namo Namo.
See you soon, Swamiji.
Hari Om.